Deeper Insights into the Illuminati Formula by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 33. How Help Comes About for Mind Control Victims. Continues. Rationales, of the abusers. Persons, who are just getting into the subject of Illuminati mind control, naturally ask why do the abusers do what they do? And how can the abusers mentally justify doing what they do? We will not attempt to give a comprehensive answer to this question, which would take a book, but will try to give a condensed version of why it happens, and how it is justified in the abusers' minds. First, we'll look at what psychologists are saying, and then we will build upon that to give a more accurate sketch of why the abuse happens. Psychologists who have studied parents who sexually abuse their children have concluded that such parents are extremely narcissistic. Narcissism means self-love. They go on to say that essentially everyone is narcissistic, but the abusers are extremely so. The psychologists are on the right track, but not quite there. Hold this thought for a moment. The psychologists also think that the sexual abuse is done to gratify the abuser's need for a reward, in the same vein that some are also alcoholics. The mind control abuser needs to be worshipped, which will gratify the need to be desirable and important. Because children idolize adults, and since children are innocent and powerless, the abuser enjoys dominating the child sexually, mentally, and spiritually. Because knowledge of the seven brains has been kept away from the public's general awareness, the public and psychologists don't think in these terms. Knowledge of the seven separate brains that make up the human mind are how the Illuminati successfully carry out mind control. Psychologists carrying out research have reported between 40 to 80% of the abusers were abused themselves as children. When it pertains to trauma-based mind control, we can assure the reader that 99.999% of the abusers have been abused themselves as children. That abuse has locked the abuser into making the reptilian brain their principal brain. The reptilian mind thinks only in terms of survival. It thinks in terms of its own needs. What the psychologists call narcissism is simply the survival type thinking, the self-love so to speak, of the reptilian brain which we all have. The only difference is that some non-multiples are able to develop their higher brains so that they can develop their conscience and true spiritually enlightened thinking as the guiding source of their actions. Everyone has a reptilian first brain. Almost any male can be made to tap into that survival instincts and can be made to be sadistic. The programmers create clean slate altars which are created in the crucible of survival. When a person fears for his life, the higher brains are shut down. These altars are simply working from the reptilian brain. They are power-based, greed-based, survival instinct-based altars. These altars are then given scripts that morally justify this thinking, so that the reptilian brain can block any future second thoughts from the two highest brains. This is where Illuminati Luciferian doctrine is important. The Illuminati teach their grand masters that they are the elite of the world, that their rulership is their birthright, and that Lucifer has taught them programming so that they can be a god, and follow after Lucifer's own heartbeat. They believe that they are pleasing Lucifer by carrying out mind control on children and then presenting these little treasures to Lucifer. These Illuminati programmers are not going to say, "I doing this because I'm a sinner," which is a higher brain concept, but they are going to say, "I'm doing this because I'm a god." Power is a need that stems from the reptilian brain. Power can be directed into proper channels by our higher brains, but due to the mind control that the Illuminati programmers themselves have received, there is nothing structured in the mind to veto this power-hungry thinking. Also, satanic doctrines, like Lavey's and Crowley's Do What Thou Wilt, give the mind a blocker to prevent the higher brains from overriding the actions based on the reptilian brain's selfish survival-based thinking. There are many other rationalizations, for instance, this is the way our fathers and forefathers have traditionally done things, no pain no gain, and this child, such as Marilyn Monroe, would have been a nothing, but by carrying out the programming we are building the person into something. The world system has set up dialectics such as the Cold War, which gave lower echelon abusers the survival-based justifications that mind-controlled slaves were needed if their side were to win the Cold War, and protect their nation. They justify their criminal behavior by saying that most people want leaders, and they are merely providing that leadership. Most people have been conned into accepting the leadership of others. Most people go through a stage in life like the hippies, where they want to think for themselves, but just like the hippie movement, they end up taking the attitude, if you can't beat them, join them. But even the most average of persons has an incredible computer between the ears, and are far more capable than they are given credit for. At least the potential is there, if it weren't stolen by an education system that dumbs students down, and the other hassles in life that steal so much potential from people. Because the abusers have seared their consciences, they often look at the abuse as a game, albeit a sadistic one. At that point, several of them may try to outdo each other, and the abuse becomes an ongoing contest to see who can outdo each other. In some cases, not only do the hidden Luciferian doctrines support the abuse, such as reincarnation, but the front altar's religious views may also support the abuse. Numerous passages in the Talmud give legal religious sanction for pedophilia, torture, and other crimes. Because this fact has been covered up, it would be appropriate to quote some of the fuller Talmudic translations, because some of the translations into English leave out passages that are in the original Hebrew which promote such things as pedophilia and sodomy. The Book of Yebamoth of the Talmud, 2 volumes, London, The Sansino Press, 1936, page 397 states, harlotry is not applicable to bestial intercourse. In other words, intercourse with a beast is not regarded as a sin of intercourse. Page 402, as well as 403, of the same Talmudic book states, that it is okay for a priest to have cohabitation with a girl proselyte under 3. It states, a proselyte who is under the age of 3 years and 1 day is permitted to marry a priest, or the daughter of a proselyte is eligible to live with a priest and have intercourse. In Ketuboth, another book of the Talmud, pages 54, 57, 58, 59 provide more examples of legal religious justification of adults having sex with children. For instance, on PG 58 it states, when a grown-up man has intercourse with a little girl it is nothing, although the intercourse of a small boy is not regarded as a sexual act, nevertheless the woman is injured by it as by a piece of wood. This does not mean that all readers of the Talmud practice such things, but it's one example of many of how religious beliefs and cultural beliefs give sanction to abuse. Some deranged criminals are hiding behind their religious covers, and these religious covers are across the board. Some small-size cults teach that free sex between all persons is liberation and love. In such cases, one has a layering of rationalizations, from the front clear down to the deeper levels. And as for the abuse, many of the handlers think that it is okay because they have the ability to erase any memory of the abuse from the slave's mind, and make it okay. They also rationalize that they are expanding the mind of their slaves. You've all heard the New Age claptrap that man is on the edge of a new evolutionary leap forward, and they talk themselves into believing they are part of that great leap forward. Some of the leading mind researchers, who help program, seem to honestly believe this. As ridiculous as this may sound, people will believe ridiculous things if it will justify to their own minds the cruelty they perpetuate on innocent people. At the heart of all the mind control, you will find the heartbeat of Lucifer and the willingness of his followers to do what they believe he wants. Reality vs. Perception. This article will discuss the ins and outs of an altar's perception of things and the external world. In many ways, it might be helpful for the client and the therapist to view each other as two beings from separate worlds who need to learn some common means to communicate. Stephen Talman said, "All knowledge bears the imprint of the mind's own structure. There is some truth that our minds help us organize our perceptions. A newborn baby will turn its head toward a sound, even though it has not had any experience in the world that would teach it that anything important is in the direction of the sound. It knows to do this because it is born with this ability. As the magician uses a sleight of hand, the programmer uses a sleight of the mind's abilities to learn. As we live in the real world, we grow up and learn meanings to words. Our ideas are representations of what exists in the world. The problem between the programmed multiple and the common person in the street who is not programmed, is that the programmed multiple's experiences indeed make his or her ideas representations that exist in the reality that the programmers created for the various altars. One might say that many of these objects in an internal world are objects of a multiple's imagination. This may be ultimately true, but the programming has a reality of its own and may be the best reality that the altar has had a chance to apprehend. For instance, at one point Fritz hooked up a heart/pulse monitor to prove to an altar that she had a heart. However, this altar was programmed to trance out if hooked up to such a device. The device read no pulse, and the altar said, "See, I told you I had no heart." Fritz was chagrined, but he didn't give up. He explained that the programming was causing this altar to trance, so the altar tried hard not to trance, and the next time, there was a weak reading. The third time, there was even a better reading, as the altar mastered the ability to stay grounded. When people remember something or imagine something, one cannot be sure if these ideas relate to something that really existed. Generally, when a person perceives something, unless he is drunk, his perception is going to conform to reality. However, the programmers mess with the mind of victims so much, that the deeper alters only live in a deep hypnotic trance. They only perceive as they have been programmed to perceive. This really is a tribute to how incredible the human mind is. The human mind can creatively design all kinds of concepts and can function in an imaginary world if that is what it takes to survive. One of the things that most of the alters need to develop is a sense of external reality. This means that they need to spend time holding the body and experiences life outside of their external world which they live in. They will also need to learn that truth is not whatever you make it. Of course, the victim of mind control already has many doubts, and to realize that they can't trust their own judgment is difficult to accept. Some of the alters will be left brain and some will be right brain alters. The therapist will experience various quasi-psychotic symptoms, but there is no reason to be alarmed by it. It simply comes with the territory. Because the alter's systems are complex, and may be subjected to programming at a particular time, alters may not present a consistent picture. The therapist may begin to wonder if the entire thing is a very complex game for the client's alters. Over time, the therapist will begin to sort things out. If the client does not have the ability to communicate, there may develop many incidents that are difficult to understand. Again, the therapist needs to remind her or himself that there is probably a good reason why the alters are acting the way they are acting. As this book has repeatedly brought out, the phenomena of programmed multiplicity has been very poorly understood by therapists. Responsibilities, tips to face new ones. The programmers succeed in what they do, because they know how the mind works, and they work with the victim's mind. The support team must do the same. The programmers know how the mind needs the stage set for it to learn new things, and they will take the time and effort to lay the groundwork, the foundation. Likewise, when the deeper alters begin experiencing the real external life, they need to have the groundwork, the stage set for them to learn new things. The deeper alters can be encouraged to put their survival skills to work. The deeper alters need to forget the I can'ts and recognize that they have powerful survival skills that can be redirected to make them successful in the external world. When deeper alters who are learning about the outside world see a need, they need to tackle that need. If one sees dirty dishes, then wash them. If one sees a barren front yard, plant some flowers. If one sees a hurting person, give solace. By using their powers of observation, the deeper alters can see needs and address those needs around them. This will give them a sense of accomplishment and power. They will then begin to recognize their worth and their potential. After one looks around for needs to address, the next step is to ask yourself what you'd like to try doing. If you think you'd like to do something, then try it. Go to a hobby shop, or to the library and get some ideas on what new activity you can do. you will be surprised at what you will be able to accomplish. Altar can help altars, and can work together as teams on new projects. Deeper altars need to have the goal of having a full range of emotions. Emotions will help them achieve maturity. Anyway, who gave the right to the programmers to say you can't step outside of programming? Salvation, obtaining it, issues for multiples. An infant will enjoy playing with a box, and later as a child will enjoy trees. When the child gains an intellectual understanding of boxes and trees as an adult, the simple fun of being with these things is lost. Sometimes people would enjoy God more if they didn't become so intellectual about Him, and just played with Him as a child. There are a number of people who insist on quarreling about what has already passed. How could God have done this? Why is God so cruel? Why is God so merciful? Why does God love me a sinner? Why does God hate me a sinner? With something so vast and big like God, He often gets the same treatment accorded the weather, in that everyone has their own opinion of how the weather should be. If we couldn't understand adults as children, why do we think we can understand God? Wouldn't it be more fun if we could crawl up in His spiritual arms and experience His concern and kindness, rather than trying to dissect His actions with intellectual theories? But one thing God's Word makes clear, our happiness is not His goal for us in life, His goal is that we would be conformed to the image of Christ. When we see our problems in that light, we see that our problems are actually just what we needed to develop the Christ-like ministry God wants for us. Did you ever wonder why your parents wanted you to have good habits, you wanted to play, and they wanted you to have good habits? They weren't interested in your idea of happiness, they were trying to develop character. But rather than fight with God, why don't we try to have some childlike wonder, isn't it amazing how beautiful life is? Watch a spider spin a web. Watch the sunset. Watch a mother cat and her kittens. We sometimes think that our own problems are unique. We like to think that our modern world has its own unique problems. Western civilization has been built upon the ancient wisdom of the Word of God. The Bible records that in ancient times there were child sacrifices, for example, C2KGS 17:17, satanic rituals where they did self-inflicted cuts, for example, IKGS 18:26-28, witches who used magic paraphernalia like rings, EZEKIEL 13:17-21, secret magic books, Acts 19:17-19, child prostitution, for example, IKGS 14:24, and Job 36:14, and political leaders who were into satanic witchcraft, 2KGS 21:1-16, and much more. On and on we could go describing many of the same problems that people face today, including mind control. This does not mean everything was exactly the same. The Roman toilets and swimming pools looked similar to ours, but their elite had only four-wheeled carts rather than cars. Obviously, a Roman senator didn't have to worry about a flat tire. But when it comes to matters about the human soul, the human spirit, eternal salvation, guilt, shame, greed, and hate, and tax collectors, the issues are exactly the very same issues as they were thousands of years ago. The ancient wisdom of the ancients, which is embodied in the Holy Bible, is still as rich and powerful for us today as it was in ancient times. That ancient wisdom said, "Open your mouth for the speechless, and plead the cause of the poor and needy," Proverbs 3:1-8. I wish we could find a few Christians who would stand with us to open their mouths for all the altar personalities of the 2 million mind-controlled slaves in this country who do not have a voice, and that we could plead the cause of these needy mind-controlled victims throughout this land. What you sow, you reap. In street parlance, this translates what goes around, comes around. If we want to reap some salvation for ourselves, we had better sow some salvation. What have you been planting? One of the most difficult topics for programmed multiples and for those who work with them is the question, how do programmed multiples get salvation? We have been saved, we are being saved, and we will be saved. Salvation comes in many tenses. If one altar gives his life to Christ, does that save an entire system? Can a system of altars lose their salvation if the front is Christian and the deeper parts are active in rituals where humans are sacrificed? How can a person be two things at once? Does each altar need a separate baptism? Is it wrong to baptize different altars of one system? These are a few of the questions that have plagued multiples. God is not a respecter of persons. Everyone will be treated equally and equitably by God. There is not one standard for multiples and another for non-multiples. The question is, just what are God's standards? It may surprise the reader to be told that in spite of all the preaching that is going on today, many of the teachings of Christ and the teachings of the Bible have been lost, including many that concern salvation. Christ said it was foolish to gain the whole world, but to lose one's own soul. By extension, it would be foolish to gain power over all the internal worlds of oneself or of another person, and to lose one's own soul. Don't be foolish, don't lose your soul. Can you imagine a company building an exclusive ship like the Queen Mary, installing many beautiful things, the latest communication equipment, the best safety equipment, and then when it is completed, set the ship adrift without a crew to float aimlessly around and to be tossed by each storm and to sink without any purpose? The human is far more wonderfully made than any ship. Our brains are still far superior in many ways to the best computers. Do you think that God created mankind and crowned him with glory and honor according to his word in PS 8:5, just to cast mankind adrift? Some men have decided that man is adrift. That man must chart his own course, somewhat like the ship deciding to sail itself. Adam Smith, a Scottish intellectual of the 18th century, was convinced that science would save mankind from war and superstition, which is how he viewed Christianity. Science did not save us from war, nor have the teachings of Christ lost meaning as some superstitious gobbledygook, but the words of Christ are just as powerful today as they were 2,000 years ago. Christ said that the truth shall set men free, and those words are no less true today than they were in his day. There are plenty of philosophies that will convince you that you were designed by God merely to be abandoned, that there is no purpose to life. But why did the prodigal son feel miserable eating with the pigs? Because he was a man and he knew that he was meant to have a better life. People know that they are called to something better. They are often not content to think that their life is meaningless, because they know better. In the sight of God the Creator, there are no common people, only special important people that He ordained. Almighty God loves us better than we love ourselves. Not Sally over here because she goes to church several times a week, nor Sue over here because she has the Bible memorized better than anyone else. He loves us, all of us, good and bad, because He created us, and as our Creator He loves what He created in His own image. Christ asked people to get to know Him. He didn't ask His disciples to go to church on Sunday. He didn't give them a Bible and command them to follow the Bible, He asked them to learn from Him and to follow Him and to get to know Him. God allowed a persecution to come upon the early Christians so they would quit going to church and would go to the world and tell them the good news that their Creator loved them and had a plan for their lives. That day a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered. So the people who were scattered went from place to place telling the good news. Acts 8:1 The good news is not that you are unworthy. God's word says that all are worthy of anything good that He has. The good news is not that we are rejected and worthy of punishment. God's word says that He suffered rejection and punishment so that we can realize that we don't need to. The good news is not that we should be ashamed of ourselves and walk around in guilt. I'm sure most of you were told at some point, "Shame on you, you are a bad person." God sent His only begotten Son to love us, not to judge us. Don't you think He knew what people were like, when He came to show us God's love? The self-righteous and those with religious spirits enjoy making people feel guilty. They threaten you with rejection, punishment, and want us to lower our self-esteem. After a while a person surrenders to their incessant religious spirits, and decides that I'm stupid, I'm worthless, I'm bad, etc. But guilt is not the answer. Guilt is not the good news. but you may be protesting, but isn't that what the Bible wants? Doesn't it want us to be guilty? Doesn't it say, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God? Doesn't it say, all of us like sheep have gone astray? Each has turned to his own way? Doesn't it say, for whoever keeps the whole law, yet stumbles in one point, he has become guilty of all. Surprises of surprises, the Bible never asks man to feel guilty. The biblical Greek words that translate guilt, hypodikos, aphelo, and inakos, mean guilty in the same sense that if you leave your car overparked and the meter runs out, you have violated a law and are guilty of violating that law, but that is something entirely different than feeling guilty. We have been told all our lifetimes by the modern-day Pharisees that it is God who wants us to feel guilty. God wants us to feel loved. God wants us to realize that He loves us more than we can ever love ourselves. God is love. God never tells us that God is guilt. I can do all things through Christ Jesus who lives in me. Wow! How can God expect us to have a low opinion of ourselves if He tells us that we can do all things through Christ? He never expected us to have a low opinion of ourselves. Jesus is called the most humblest man ever, and yet He had no sins to castigate Himself about. He couldn't crawl in the dust and plead for God's mercy on His wretchedness, so how did He get to be the humblest man? Because humility is not self-denigration. We have been fed a lie here too by the religious Pharisees of our day. Humility means knowing God's plan for your life. God wants us to learn His ways, which are the ways of love. Religious spirits don't want to treat people with love, they want to judge them, they want to hit them over the head with religion, they want to legalistically find ways to prove that their fellow man is bad. They can always show you how they are right and the other person is wrong. They like to use the law, but they seldom use love. The Word of God says that the letter of the law kills, but the Spirit of love gives life. Yes, man has fallen greatly, and mankind sins greatly. But where sin abounds, God's love and strength are poured out in more abundance. Christ said, "If God clothes the wild flowers in all their beauty, won't He do more for you if you have faith?" On the one hand is the beauty of mankind bought with a price in the image and glory of God and in the likeness of God, and on the other hand this beautiful image of God has wandered off in total rebellion to His Creator. But even in that state of rebellion, God still sees worth and value in a man. The enemies of God, such as the mind control programmers, love to make people think that God has rejected them because they are bad. And since our parents didn't listen to us, and told us we were bad, we think that God acts like our parents. But the message that Christ's disciples gave was not one of guilt and shame and religious rules, but sounded like this: for David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell on sleep, and was laid unto his fathers, and saw corruption. Be it known unto you therefore, men and brethren, that through this man Jesus is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins, and by him all that believe are justified from all things, from which ye could not be justified by the law of Moses. Acts 19:36-39. When my deeper alters thought about forgiveness, the programming kicked in and I got suicidal. These alters had been programmed to think they had no heart, that they were bad, etc. Forgiveness was a concept that they could not grasp. But these alters were able to take the first step of faith. Allow me to switch to first person. I told myself, if God said it, I had to believe it, because God said whosoever asks for forgiveness is forgiven. The day you seek me with your whole heart is the day you'll find me. CFPS 34:8-10, 2 Chr 15:2, Heb 10:22. I stepped outside of the programming and believed God was the integrity of His own word. I couldn't rationalize the forgiveness, I simply accepted it on the basis of God's integrity. As the months passed, I realized that the Holy Spirit had quietly done His work, and had freed me from the guilt that I had carried, and freed me from the effects of the programming. I did feel forgiven. I didn't intellectually comprehend forgiveness, the programming blocked me mentally, but it couldn't block the Holy Spirit working in my heart. Forgiveness came to my deeper parts by standing on the Word of God. Now I was free to acknowledge the things God had for me in life. If your prayers are not going anywhere, and you feel like God is not hearing your prayers, then quit praying, and start trusting that God knows your situation. He knows the trouble you're in. Place some trust and faith in Him. Quit fearing, and start having some faith. An innocent child is birthed out of heaven. The Word of God says that Christ died for all men, the entire world. He was the Lamb of God who took away the sins of the world. He was the second Adam, who corrected the curse that Adam brought upon mankind. It is very clear in Scripture that you will only be held accountable for the sins that you have done. Adam's sins are not imputed to you. The goal of the Illuminati is to take the innocent child and perform mind control upon it before it can know right from wrong, before it has stepped outside of its innocence. The perverted joy that Satan gets in marrying and polluting the innocence of a small child is part of why things happen the way they do. What happens when free will is stripped from a young innocent child? Those parts that do have free will stand in proxy for those who are trapped. How did God judge a city? God told Abraham he would spare Sodom and Gomorrah if he could find a few righteous persons within them. God told Abraham that if he could find 10 righteous men in the city of Sodom, then he would spare it. If a person's front altars have free will, they will stand in proxy for those who do not have free will. Persons are not responsible for action under extreme duress, nor are contracts valid legally if they are contracted under duress. Likewise, those altars who have no free will are not in a situation where they can choose right from wrong. They become accountable when they are free of the mind control and can choose between right and wrong. In other words, front altars can indeed save a city of altars, if they are the only ones with free will and they are righteous. But with freedom comes responsibility. There are numerous cases of non-multiples coming forward for numerous altar calls, and repeatedly giving themselves to Christ. There are plenty of cases of non-multiples receiving repeat baptisms. As much as this happens, it seems strange that some ministers will deny altars who come to Christ the chance to be baptized. If the altar wants to make a personal public confession of faith, they should be allowed to do it. And the co-authors will be happy to help victims with this area of concern. If a person is really okay with the Lord, do you think that going into the water and getting baptized is going to injure that relationship? Does the reader really think God is that petty and has that little compassion? What kind of person do some people think God is? And that is probably one of the big secrets to gaining salvation, discovering who God really is, versus what all the modern religious Pharisees say about Him. You are not going to find salvation by submitting yourself to an organized religious group that takes your free will away. Christ came to give you free will to seek God on your own. He came to set men free of religious tyranny. Unfortunately, after setting men free of religious tyranny, many have come using His name and have established religious tyranny. And they usually justify their tyranny by distorting the character and nature of God. What you sow, you reap. If you want a spiritual life, you need a spiritual birth. It's that simple. You don't plant a natural life and get a spiritual life. Our salvation package 1. Provides for a full and complete pardon for all sins of commission and omission of which a sinner might be guilty. 2. Provides for a cleansing from all unrighteousness which results from said sinner's behavior. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 3. Provides for the judge of all the earth, remembering our sins no more. 4. Provides for the sins to be blotted out as a thick cloud, and put away as far as the east is from the west. 5. Provides for clearing of the conscience by way of asking for forgiveness, not just apologizing, and making restitution where it is possible to restore the damages. Sanctuary, safe room, creating a sanctuary. Therapists working in tandem with clients have built internal safe rooms for altars to view memories together, or to work on issues together in safety. They may also construct new living quarters for altars as they work with the front systems and try to stabilize, integrate, and fuse altars. The concept of building safe rooms internally to protect altars from internal attacks is a good idea for therapists, but it has limited success. There is nothing wrong with using internal sanctuaries, if the therapist realizes the ins and outs of creating and using one. Safe rooms created by the therapist and client work better for the front altars than for deeper altars. Every change in the system comes with a price tag. Programming has its own kind of security. The programmers allowed altars to build their own internal worlds and the homes they live in. They have felt safe in their internal residences for years. When they abandon their internal homes, it doesn't have a safe feeling, and then they are pounced upon by numerous internal mechanisms to not disturb the peace and order of the system, such as judge altars with armies who enforce the order of the system with pain and punishment. So they have exchanged their comfortable internal home for a palace with pain. No matter how beautiful the therapist makes the safe room, it is still will be a place of pain. During deprogramming, when we wanted to preserve temporary gains, it was possible to creatively think of some type of internal structure like an accessible mountain with a hollow oak to hide in or an invulnerable spaceship where an altar could have refuge from the internal programmers. The problem is as long as those internal programmers are operating, they are cagey and they can creatively think of some way to overcome the imagery of the new safe place. Generally within 48 hours they had figured out some way to recapture the altar and had started attempts to reprogram the altar. This means that every 2 days a new safe hiding place has to be created, unless a sloppy job is done and the system defenders break through very quickly, and then a sanctuary may have to be built even sooner. And telling this just underscores the need to work on why the altars are making their changes in their life. Why are they fighting the programming? They need to be reminded. If the support team wants to create an internal sanctuary, and are aware of its vulnerability, then the therapist needs to work with the altar being protected to find out what the altar feels is safe. The altar may have lived internally in a box and may not know what a large room is. The altar may not even feel comfortable in a large room. Perhaps the altar has been around numerous other altars and has always heard noisy chattering. How will the altar feel if the altar is now going to be isolated in a safe room? The safe room may end up feeling more like maximum security. In other words, the therapist needs to work with the altar and the altar's creativity to secure the best choice of safety. Other supportive altars can help. Internal telephone lines can be put in to keep altars in touch with each other. Satanic cults, understanding the practice of. For a certain part of mankind, the drive for power has developed the power to fashion other men. But what power controls those who have gained the power to fashion the minds of men as they choose? Is that power which controls the programmers merely the latent potential of the human mind? Or is that power merely a mass hallucination, or an auto-suggestion by these programmers? Or to rephrase these questions more bluntly, does Lucifer and his demons really control the programmers? Or do they only halfway pretend that demons exist, because if you believe in something, anything, then supposedly it will work? For the power-hungry, truth and fiction are but tools to gain power. There is an appealing theory that the CIA, Anton LaVey, a Satanist and programmer, Michael Aquino, a Satanist and programmer, and others of the occult underworld find witchcraft and spells appealing simply because it gives power, and that they do not believe in an actual character named Satan. LaVey and Aquino both convincingly claim that they do not believe in Satan. They also lie convincingly that they don't carry out human sacrifices. Who knows the hearts of these programmers? At the heart of evil is the quest for power. That is what is at the root of the love of money. At the heart of evil is a philosophy of death that must act as if it is a philosophy of life. Because the Illuminati is not able to see the true meaning of life, on the surface nothing seems to count but personal power, but is there something else? Yes, there is, and we know it for a fact because we were there. These programmers are prisoners of their quest for power, but they also believe that there is a greater power that they serve which will reward them. Again the question begs itself when they are captured by their insatiable quest for power, have they surrendered themselves to a neutral thing, Or have these programmers surrendered their life to a higher power? Everyone is willing to concede that these satanic movers and shakers are obsessed with gaining power. If these men want power so bad, and have such resources available, would they devote so much time and resources to something that didn't work? But the rational thinker can correctly answer, much of magic is trickery, natural unknown forces in nature, or some unknown power of mind over matter. The rational thinker argues, it works, but not by supernatural forces. Psychic abilities are merely untrained RV abilities. But the surrender to demonic forces always brings with it a desire for the irrational. If reason were to have a central place in the magician's worldview, then much of what the magician believes would have to be discarded. Castaneda's occult classic Tales of Power, New York, Simon & Schuster, 1974, p. 101 states, we, the luminous beings the Illuminati, are born with two rings of power, but we use only one to create the world. That ring, which is hooked very soon after we are born, is reason, and its companion is talking. Between the two they concoct and maintain the world. So, in essence, the world that your reason wants to sustain is the world created by a description and its dogmatic and inviolable rules, which the reason learns to accept and defend. The secret of the luminous beings is that they have another ring of power which is never used, the will. The trick of the sorcerer is the same trick of the average man. Both have a description, one, the average man, upholds it with his reason, the other, the sorcerer, upholds it with his will. The advantage of the sorcerer is that will is more engulfing than reason. From now on you should let yourself perceive whether the description is upheld by your reason or your will. The child victim while they are being programmed are told that if they want something bad enough they can create it. Hitler, a secret Satanist, never quit preaching the power of the will. If the German people willed to win, then they could, was Hitler's magical perception. When individuals lost the will to fight, Hitler held those individuals accountable, rather than external circumstances for their lack of fight. Mind over matter. This is the sorcerer's worldview. There have been and continue to be plenty of gullible people who want to believe the deceptions of the cults. What you see is not what you get. The world of reason must be left behind to understand the Illuminati. We must think in terms of willpower and power of all kinds. We must think in irrational terms. We must grasp what it is like to be addicted to power, and the quest for hidden knowledge to gain more power, and power through deception. The mystery religions, which continue today in their hardcore form as the Illuminati, and their more ceremonial symbolism as Freemasonry, have had thousands of years to perfect their deceptions. The victim of mind control experiences the depth of how powerful the perpetrator's network of deception is. The Illuminati and the Masonic perpetrators of mind control have a system of secrecy so pervasive and well in place that you will not see the obvious telltale signs that most people would look for when they initially hear that something is amiss. Even the visible front of the occult world is overlooked by many people. Along this line, when a therapist or victim begins to catch on to the mind control, immediately the natural questions present themselves: how did they have time to do this? And where could they have done all this? These questions may stem from genuine concern that the person not jump to false conclusions, but they also are predicated on a lack of understanding about how the Illuminati and associated cults work. For reasonable people who are disposed to learn, we can provide the inside story on how the unexplainable can be explained. For those who have made up their minds and are not interested, all we have to ask is this: how do you explain this present wicked world, and how do you explain how incompetent our government seems to be in correcting problems? How is it that billions of dollars get looted from the entire savings and loan industry by hundreds of insiders and no one ever gets punished? How is it that Russian generals pilot our most secret stealth bombers, but US Air Force personnel get shot if they approach a stealth bomber without authorization? Actually, when we think of it, the list of anomalies of this present system are endless. We could honestly ask hundreds of questions of things that don't make sense, unless you understand how the Illuminati are running things. Take a minute to think about how important power is to the military and to the alphabet spy agencies. Their quest for power lines them up philosophically with the occult world's philosophy. Truth for warriors and spies is merely a tool. The men who will rise to the top of such organizations are those who will defend the satanic philosophy of using willpower to create one's worldview. During our time within the Illuminati, we can say for a fact that Freemasonry and the Illuminati are interlocked. The Masonic system has lodges and temples that public can see, but don't think that they are not smart enough to create a system of secret lodges. They have a system of secret lodges, and secret tunnels to temples that allow them to carry out human sacrifices and sexual rituals without the mainstream of lower-level Masons even knowing what Freemasonry is all about. In a female Illuminati system, the Sisters of Light altars will be created before the Illuminati Mothers of Darkness. All Mothers of Darkness have to have Sister of Light altars. However, the Sisters of Light altars, which are used during the body's teenage years, are extremely difficult to find. Why? Because the Sisters of Light are created for extremely abusive Masonic sexual rituals that are done in both visible and secret Masonic temples. The teenage girl may be used on Friday, by quietly pulling the child out of school for a preparation ritual by the Masons, and then on Saturday and Sunday the teenage child Sister of Light altars will participate in the actual full-blown rituals. Demonology, and its relation to mind control and the satanic cults. If you investigate into the depths of darkness in the hearts of men, where will it lead you? Your investigation will take you into demonology. In its nicer forms, it shows itself as mysticism and spiritism. It is upon demonology that the Illuminati is founded. It is from demonology that the rituals and the mind control spring forth. Of course, those who have no previous knowledge of this will be the first to feel qualified to pass judgment that magic and demons are merely urban myths. In the rarefied air of academia, denial of satanic ritual abuse is like an opium addiction. If corruption and organized crime need satanic philosophies to justify their acts, then they also need demonology to provide the spiritual power and guidance. It all becomes one dynamic. Sacrifice and gore are necessary to harness spiritual power, secrecy is demanded to perform such a bloodlusting magical tradition, and control of the outside world then is needed to hide the crimes done for power. A mind-controlled slave's hidden life is based upon the spirit world. The science of dealing with spirits is called the Kabbalah. Theurgy is a high degree of occultism where the magician can evoke angels, evil, exalted spirits, genii, fire spirits. Within the Illuminati, we were Luciferians, also known as Gnostics, not Satanists. That does not mean that Satan doesn't play a role in the occultism of the Illuminati, it means that satanic cults tend to be deranged dabblers, and the Illuminati are sophisticated blue-blooded bloodlines that view themselves as the elite of the world. But whether one is part of a satanic cult or the Illuminati or some other occult group, the foundation of what is done is demonology. With ruthless dedication, the upcoming Illuminati undertake to transform themselves into magicians and witches who can control the spirits. Controlling spirits gives power. Satanic dabblers are not the only practitioners of necromancy, so are the Illuminati. You will find the Illuminati in graveyards for some of their rituals. Many of the Illuminati rituals are so severe only persons with multiple personalities, or great dissociative abilities, could endure them and maintain a functioning sanity. Although we can write with authority about demonology and the Illuminati and its relationship to programming, we hope to show a few tidbits of the paper trail that could be amassed to add validity to what we want to share. A member of the elite Stewart bloodline, R.J. Stewart, provides a paper trail of what we also experienced in the Illuminati. The developing practitioner of advanced magical arts must have grounding and experience in the following disciplines: meditation, concentration, visualization, and ritual pattern making. No advanced work may be undertaken without training and experience in these four skills. There are five fundamental arts or disciplines in magical work, and the first four tend to lead towards the fifth, which is meditation. Stewart, R.J. Advanced Magical Arts. Longmead, England, 1988, p. P8, this is also in Stewart, R.J. Living Magical Arts. Blandford Press, Poole, 1987. The same abilities that are needed for advanced magic, according to this great magic adept and member of the Scottish Stewarts, are the same abilities needed for becoming a programmed multiple. The mind control with its abilities to endure pain, to go into trances, to visualize is really a natural outgrowth of the deeper black magical arts. The eastern branch of the secret occult world is Indian Yogism, and it is well known how they have developed total control of their minds and bodies. They can go into altered states and sleep on beds of nails or walk on hot coals. Because demonology is based upon power, and power is obtained by fighting to the top, a child victim is soon taught that if they do not perform, they will bring harm upon their cult bloodline. In high-level magic, there is no room for failure. The bloodlines and individuals are locked in intense rivalries, and individuals are expected to contribute to the competition. The child victim is expected to blindly obey all orders within the family. The victim is to never ask why or ask about the consequences of an order. The victim is warned, if you ever break this oath, may all the darkness of the family fall upon you as the same daggers pierce your heart through and through. After such an oath, the child will be ordered to worship Lucifer, and carry out Luciferian chants. Some of the oaths and secrets are beginning to see the light of day. J.K. Huysmans wrote in La Basse, French for down there, that one of the Illuminati oaths at that time of the French Revolution, and still used, was, lightning does not strike so quickly as the dagger which will reach thee wherever thou mayest be. Self-forgiveness, to achieve. One of the major blocks preventing deprogramming is the lack of self-forgiveness that altars maintain. Some churches have it backwards, they think that the victims need to forgive their abusers from the start. The victims do not even recognize what their abusers have done, and the victims generally blame themselves, unfairly, for much of what was done to them. The victim needs first to work on self-forgiveness, then learn what has really been done, and finally, when the memories are all worked on, and the person has completely integrated, then the victim can honestly forgive their abusers. Mouthing some words about forgiveness without understanding what the sin was that was done to the victim is only pretending to work on the issue. The bitterness that is embedded in their hearts and minds needs a proper release, and unfortunately most of this bitterness is turned by victim themselves on themselves, not against the abusers, who are the ones who really should be held responsible. Because self-forgiveness is such a major issue, it has already been covered some in Volume 2, p. 284, and in our Deeper Insights article on salvation. Those who have studied the professional literature on treatment of MPD/DID will notice a deathly silence in most professional literature on the topic of self-forgiveness. All Illuminati victims of mind control have been terrorized by their abusers about how God hates them and how God will punish them for their badness. The mind has had to accept the repeated messages that the programmers will drill into the victim that the victim is bad. Why will the mind accept this message so conclusively? The mind is preset to expect love from parents. Every animal and every person expects care and love from its mother when it's born. When the child does not receive what it expects, then it has no choice but to conclude, I must be bad for so many people to treat me this way. These all-knowing big people must have a reason for abusing me, and they say it's because I'm bad, and all the evidence shows that I'm bad, so I must be very bad. It's a vicious cycle. The programming makes the child feel defective, and the feelings of being defective and guilty make the child feel shame. All these feelings combine to make the person hate him or herself. The victim of mind control has had a foundation of guilt and humiliation laid into their unconscious mind. Memorizing a Bible verse and repeating some verse like it's a mantra is not going to root out that foundation, which is firmly embedded. Programs which attempt to show deeper alters their identity in Christ will hit lots of strongholds and triggers and may get bogged down in fierce resistance. The struggle for self-forgiveness will be a process. It is a process of sanctification that the Holy Spirit will work in a person over a period of time. The mind needs time to process and sort things out. the bitterness and self-hatred were not wired into the mind in countless neural synapses and K-lines overnight. It will take time for the mind to rewire itself. Here are some tips, and the reader may have already thought of these. Study the Word of God about self-forgiveness. Pray for self-forgiveness. Be gentle and patient. It takes time for the mind to overcome its foundation of self-hatred. Keep bathing the mind in positives and washing away the negatives. Over a period of time, a healing will take place, and you will have regained the self-respect that the programmers and abusers stole from you. Split-brain programming. One of the most powerful programming tools is the use of split-brain programming. In order to ensure the continued secrecy and success of the use of alters who function only from one hemisphere, the Illuminati used their psychiatrists to spread the notion that split-brain programming was simply a hypnotic program, a trick of the mind. The reality is that one side of the brain is physically drugged to sleep with an injection while the victim is traumatized to create parts. Volume 2 covers methods used in split-brain programming. After a single hemisphere part, alter, is created, it can then be further programmed by each of its two eyes viewing different films simultaneously. Actually, the split-brain films begin during the splitting tortures. If a programmer wants a part to assassinate a particular person, they will often create a particular part for just that assignment. While they are torturing the mind to get that part who will do the job, they will be showing films of the crime supposedly done by the person who is the target of the assassination mission. The programmer doesn't know exactly when the mind will split a piece, so the films are run during the entire trauma splitting process. The crime films and what needs to be done will be run during the process. The part that is created for this specific job will be accessed after the mission and destroyed by shattering it with trauma, and then the shattered parts will be locked up in a concentration camp in the mind. This specialized type of assassination programming is done usually with men. Sometimes the programmers are too busy or don't have the patience and they merely put in a shattering program, that self-triggers when the slave's mission is complete, and shatters that piece using the internal programming capabilities of the slave's mind. This works fine, but the risk of leakage is somewhat greater. Special alters created for a single drug run or money laundering run for an important politician will be created and destroyed in a very sophisticated high-tech fashion. There will be no split-brain alter left for the therapist to work with, only tiny fragments locked up in very deep secure parts of the mind. However, the key to understanding why these dissociative pieces, alters, are so good at their jobs is split-brain programming. That is why it has been kept such a secret. Alters who have been created when only one hemisphere was awake will either operate only on logic or operate only on emotion. Alters who operate only on logic serve in roles such as assassination alters just described and internal programming alters. These alters will carry out inhumane, horrible atrocities upon others and themselves because they have no emotions. On the other side, an alter which has no logic can be hypnotically told to act like Betty Boop, the cartoon figure, and they will emotionally carry out this assignment, because they have no logic to tell them that people don't act like Betty Boop, a cartoon figure. An alter who has no logic can easily be made into a doorknob or some other illogical form. These alters will only function from the side of the mind they were created from. Over time, the Illuminati has discovered that alters with split-brain programming do not gain the advantage of the other hemisphere, but remain stunted. This is why it is so difficult for therapists to contaminate internal programmers with positive thinking. Internal programming alters can make themselves co-conscious with other alters who want to be free of programming, and the programming alters don't sense the horror of the abuse with which they subject the rest of the system. Exercises to rewire the brain's hemispheres together for split-brain alters. Brain integration therapy developed from the foundational research of Dr. Glenn and Robert Doman and an educator, Carl Delicato, and later Dr. Paul Dennison provides exercises that will develop brain pathways for integration of the hemispheres. An example of such an exercise is called the cross-scrawl. The cross-scrawl stimulates both sides of the brain and has a very positive impact on integration of the brain from side to side. The exercise is basically marching in place with the opposite hand touching the opposite knee. If it done to music, it's more fun. A variation is to try touching the opposite hand to the opposite foot in the back instead of in the front. Or one can try touching the opposite hand to the opposite heel in the front. The exercises and advice that Dr. Paul Dennison developed have solid research to validate them. This section can't possibly cover what several books cover on the subject. Interested therapists should consult the following books. Dennison, Paul E. and Gail E. Dennison. Brain Gym, Teacher's Edition. Ventura CA, EDU Kinesthetics, Inc., 1989. Dennison, Paul E. and Gail E. Dennison. Personalized Whole Brain Integration. Ventura CA, EDU Kinesthetics, Inc., 1989. Hannaford, Carla. Smart Moves, Why Learning Is Not All in Your Head. Arlington, Virginia, Grat Ocean PUB, 1995. This book was written by a neurophysicist slash educator who has researched to validate the brain integration therapy. Some therapists have explored using music that both hemispheres of the brain listen to in order to pull the two hemispheres together. Whether this helps or not is not known. Alters, who find they are only logic or emotion, can pair up with the opposite type of alter and can work in teams. By learning to co-consciously work side by side, they regain some of the brain's natural abilities to look at life both ways. Surveillance, dealing with surveillance. Spies in the Sky, this information is based upon Harold Hoff's book Satellite Surveillance. The FBI, SWAT teams, and other law enforcement, the NSA, and the military all use spy satellites. The best way to detect people from space is infrared. Spy satellite KH2, Keyhole 2, transmits its information instantly to the ground. It can circle and view a particular site every few days. Keyhole is the code word for spy satellites, and each new generation gets a higher number. Low-level electric currents on the ground known as dark currents interfere with their images. Canon and Lacrosse spy satellites are the newer generation spy satellites. Lacrosse has radar imaging with a 3 resolution. The Russians have the ability to track spy satellite locations as they have circled the globe. They could hide things as the satellites came around. The normal person can't do this, nor does the average person have a great deal to hide anyway. So what if a spy satellite can read a billboard from space? How do these spy satellites work? CCDs are used in electronic cameras in spy satellites, but the CCDs are blocked by cloud cover. Radar from satellites is also used. Radar is used from space to watch things, including what is happening in the oceans. Passive radar can see through the surfaces of underground structures. These kind of satellites are more of a threat to the privacy of objects like cars and underground shelters, than they are to people. They are not going to be able to track you as an individual. But add in the factor of a tracking implant, and the overhead satellite system becomes a nightmare. The implants are a far greater threat than any spy satellite with an electronic camera. Spies on the ground. Some of the standard surveillance techniques are given in Chapter 12. From our observations of their surveillance methods, the Illuminati handlers use the standard techniques that are taught by the military and the intelligence agencies. Quite often people who are trying to mess with slaves will use dealership cars that don't have traceable license plates. Over the years, we have seen some clever ways for mind-controlled slaves to elude their trackers. In fact, our system has had to elude some with our car at times. The first step in eluding their tracking is to realize they generally know where you are, and they are looking for ways to exploit your weakest situation. They will watch for your support person to leave. They will try to access you on your way to your therapist. They will try to access you when you are alone. They will disguise themselves as JWS, a repairman, as salesman, and other disguises too numerous to mention. Watch out for friends. Try to keep your business to yourself. Realize that everything you say over the telephone is heard by the controllers. Fritz had a hard time convincing us that the telephone wasn't safe, because it seems like such an invasion of one's privacy, and to admit it, means that one can no longer walk around with feeling that illusion of safety. Finally, after years of evidence that the phones are not private, we realize that if we talk on the phone, we need to accept that others are listening. This seems like a simple thing, but for Americans it is really difficult for them to realize that all ordinary phone calls are run through 30 computers between the caller and the receiver, and that some of those computers record all conversations. If the computer spots trigger words, your conversation will get sent on to be listened to by humans. If you don't want your conversation listened to by a person, don't use trigger words. Much of what we would suggest is common sense. We realize that the wise don't need our advice, and fools won't heed our advice. Tips for therapists. One of the first things that therapists must acclimate themselves to, is that the victim will go from one crisis to another, and many times seem a hair's breadth away from death. This is because they will actually bounce from one total disaster to another calamity. The reasons for this chaos are many, but if proper treatment through a support team can be mustered, the length of this time period of disasters may be decreased. Please don't think that the victim is simply making this all up for attention. And please don't overreact and place the victim into a hospital setting, which will only create a new set of problems. There is also a mistake on the part of some psychiatrists to try to medicate the person to suppress the symptoms. The best way to help a victim is to get the victim's alters to creatively and internally work on situations. After all, they were creative enough to survive the most horrendous traumas ever dreamed up by mankind. Another tip for therapists is that they should not play favorites with alters. The therapist is in the same situation as any leader, be he a sergeant or a kindergarten teacher. In the long run, treating all persons with respect will produce the best results. Not all systems are ready for treatment. Some systems will bug out when their programming kicks in. Love me as I am. A programmed multiple is probably the closest robot mankind will ever design that approaches being like humans. Why? Because they are humans, and that is the horror of the thing. Men can applaud when science makes true robots to assist mankind, but mankind shrinks in horror and disgust to realize that during the entire 20th century the Illuminati have been creating robots out of people with the full secret assistance of the British, American, French, and German governments. People, including therapists, shrink from the horror that slave robots are being created out of humans, so they label us anything but slaves. People will tell you, "Love me as I am." We saw one therapist tell an alter of a recovering victim, "You're nothing but programming." Are programmed feelings any less than normal human feelings? Does it hurt any less to be programmed that you lost a baby in childbirth, than to have actually lost a child? Is pain any less pain because it comes from programming and not external reality? Is there any less pain from being hypnotically convinced that they murdered a child because of your disobedience, than if it were watched in real life? Is the illusion of conscious thinking that the victim has any less an illusion than the illusion of mainstream America that common Americans determine who runs their government? Is the victim of mind control any less free than the average person who must follow the dictates of their station in life, their genetic coding, the dictates of society, the dictates of their own lack of talents, and the subtle influences of peer pressure, organized religion, and mass mind control? Not to mention the laws of physics. Perhaps there is more similarity between the mind-controlled slaves and the rest of society than we choose to admit. At any rate, the programmed thoughts and feelings of an alter should not be given any less respect nor any less validity than any other hurting person. It is time that psychologists quit throwing labels on people, and love them where they are at. Fritz and I have discussed what it is like for an observant person to watch a programmed multiple. Programmed multiples are not like other people. When you see some of the deeper alters that carry out jobs in the real world, you will notice distinct differences between their thinking and non-programmed people. The observer may find that the unusual person before them doesn't laugh as they should, and they don't follow the cues of life in quite the right cadence. The unusual person, the multiple, will seem to know about things, but when questioned in depth will be found wanting. Specifics will be lacking in explanations. It is typical of how a programmed alter thinks. At times, in situations in which mind-controlled slaves are prepared to function in, they can spew forth information that will make them look above their peers in intelligence, and at least look like non-programmed individuals. They will show discipline and appear composed. But they will not carry with them the baggage of half-baked ideas and useless memories, and half-forgotten images. Reality of non-programmed people is like a jungle full of tangled undergrowth. The programmed multiple is like a well-manicured garden. What they know, and what they are ignorant of, they are ignorant of. Their minds are more straightforward than non-multiples. Even front alters have a way of being very on task and straightforward. An observant person can use this as a clue. Learning behaviors outside of the programming are more difficult, and provide the appearance of erratic abilities. Many parts of the slave are told they have no heart and no soul. They are told they are robots, that they are slaves, that they are not human, etc. Just as an ugly child knows in its being that it is ugly by the way it has been treated by everyone in life, so also, the slave in its innermost being, is convinced that it is something less than human. The deeper alters will be amazed to see someone cry for them. The deeper alters will be amazed to see someone care about them. When the deeper alters are helped, who can blame them for loving their rescuers? But again, the alters will ask themselves, is this just another illusion? And anyway, how can anyone really care? We have hoped that by being brutally honest with what a programmed multiple is really all about, that there will be some people who can actually genuinely love multiples in the reality of who they are. For instance, in our illustrated guidebook we show a child involved in cannibalism. We are calling for solid relationships between victims and recovering slaves, not relationships based on illusions. Although the thinking of the victim has been modified to suit the Illuminati, that does not mean that victims are any less worthwhile than anyone else. Today, we lavish time and special attention to those who are handicapped and learning disabled. But to think that any person is deserving of attention because they are unusual is lopsided thinking. Our role in life to facilitate people to be the person God had intended. Underneath the superficial thoughts of the programming are special dear people who hold many of the answers to the questions so many of us ask, and to whom God has bestowed contributions and abilities for the rest of mankind. In other words, love us for being worthwhile humans, not for being an oddity, but love us in the totality of what has been done to us to make us into robotic mind-controlled slaves.